Welcome to the Headless Professor video on the post-hoc fallacy. In other words, the mistake of viewing a spurious correlation as proof that one variable caused the other. If two events are correlated, that means that the presence of one event is associated with the presence of the other event. That's what a positive correlation means. Or that the presence of one event is associated with the absence of the other event. And that's what a negative correlation means. So we can use correlation in order to predict the level of one variable from a knowledge of the other. But we should not jump to a causal conclusion that one variable is the cause of the other. Unless our data come from a formal experiment in which the supposed cause was the manipulated independent variable of that experiment. Or unless we have some other reason to believe that any other possible causal relationship between the variables is highly unlikely. Whenever we have a correlation between variables, there are four different possible explanations for that correlation. We always start with the first explanation, the so-called null hypothesis. It's possible that X could be the cause of Y, but it's also possible that Y could be the cause of X. And then it's possible that both X and Y are the mere collateral effects of some other confounding variable Z. Now, the first possible explanation is that the apparent relationship between X and Y is merely due to pure chance, luck. We have a special name for that possibility. We call it the null hypothesis. And we try to reject that before we assert any other causal relationship. The post-hoc fallacy is when someone jumps to this conclusion, that a correlation between X and Y means that X was the cause of Y. Maybe, but don't jump to that conclusion too quickly. Why couldn't it be that X is caused by Y? And couldn't it also be that both X and Y are the collateral effects of some other underlying factor, a confounding variable, Z? We have a name for that situation, too, a spurious correlation. Now, what could variable Z be? Well, in my experience, there are many possible candidates, some underlying hereditary factor, gender, age, historical cohort, or social class. One example would be the correlation between religious affiliation and educational attainment. The correlation is negative. As many atheists have pointed out, atheists tend to have a higher level of educational attainment. Now, what is the causal relationship? Is it the null hypothesis? I don't think so, because the data are based upon a large sample size. The data are statistically significant, so we can reject the null hypothesis. Many atheists then assume that because you get more education, you will start to doubt religious claims. That's possible. Atheists tout their great reliance upon common sense and reasoning, and claim that once we have more information, the reason of good judgment, we too will reject religious claims and become a great atheist genius. But that would be a post-hoc fallacy. It could be that because one is not going to church, one has more time to study, being less worried about possibly going to hell or something like that. One can focus on one's studies. That's another possible explanation. But I suggest a spurious correlation. Atheists may have more education than Christians, but maybe that's due to social class. Both atheists and people with more education tend to come from higher social classes. People who are poor tend to stick to their religion and usually don't get that far educationally. Not because they're religious, but because they're poor. Let's examine the very data more carefully. Atheists may have more education, on average, than most Christians. But how do atheists stack up against other denominations, such as Jews? Well, Jews tend to have more education. Jews also tend to have more accomplishment as scientists. It's not the atheists who are overrepresented among the world's Nobel Prize winners. It's the Jews. Now, if we examine California data even more carefully, the highest level of educational attainment in California is not the atheists. It's not even the Jews. It's Hindus. So what is the causal relationship? Well, the data are statistically significant, so we can reject the null hypothesis. So do people convert to Hinduism because they get more education? When you get your PhD, do you say, I really want to worship a god with a blue body or an elephant head? No, that would be a post hoc fallacy as well. Do they get more education because they're Hindus? Would it be a good idea to have your child convert to Hinduism so that your child will stick out schooling more, not be a dropout? I think that would be a post hoc fallacy. The relationship is spurious, and it works out something like this. Immigrants from India tend to be mostly Hindus. Immigrants from India tend to be mostly engineers, physicians, and entrepreneurs. And these careers have high levels of education. Studies show that the immigrants attracted from India tend to have very high levels of education. So immigration patterns are the underlying confounding variable behind this spurious correlation. And by the way, the atheist portrayal of some individuals as atheists does not exactly square with the writings of those individuals.